script's about to kick off. This party looks whack. Let's take it back to straight hip-hop and start it from scratch. I'm about to bloody this jack up. Everybody get back. That's why my pen needs a pad, cause my rhyme's on the red tag. Just like I did with addiction, I'm about to freak it. Like a magician, critics I turn to freak it. Got them still on the fence, whether to freak it. But quick to get impaled when I tell them freak it. I'm sick from looking pale, oh that's my freak it. About to go ahead.
What's up, it's Noah Taborda here on Full Court Press. It's our fourth episode, and it's November 13th, so we are now, 2 weeks and a day into the NBA season. Now, it's gone by pretty fast, so lots of stuff going on, some teams that have really impressed. And, games tonight, there was an exciting, thrilling game in Philadelphia. Philadelphia, obviously, one of those teams that most people thought would not be great, but they have been impressive so far. They were taking on the Rockets tonight. A couple of other big games tonight as well. Oklahoma City traveling to the LA Clippers. That's a marquee matchup. A lot of people are going to be watching. That's part of the doubleheader, also including New York and Atlanta in Atlanta. That's a tight game right now as well. And we will get to action in a sec. But first off, the number to call, 224-563-8444. Again, that is 224-563-8444. And on Blake and Noah, LA Chicago, on Sunday, we had, I think, 3 or 4 callers, which is definitely our record. Normally, we get a couple. Maybe we get one. But that was definitely our highest. And it was great, Great to have your support and all of that. So definitely call in. You should follow us on Twitter at Blake and Noah. That is at capital B-L-A-K-E underscore and underscore capital N-O-A-H. And not many followers yet. We have one or two, but definitely follow us. And then like our Facebook page, of course, Blake and Noah, LA to Chicago, just like our show name. Again, that is Blake and Noah, LA to Chicago. We are slowly climbing up that ladder. We're at 87 likes now, so we are moving up. If you go on there, you can listen to all of our past shows, all of that stuff, so you definitely should look it up. If you're interested in some of the other shows, we have the link to the National Sports Facebook page on there, so you can check out some of the other ones as well. So let's get started. And we are going to get started with a score rundown right now because there is basically a full slate. I think there are 12 games tonight. Yeah, 12 games. That means that there are only 6 teams not in action. So lots of teams playing. And we are going to start with the game in Philadelphia, which was the third game to go final, but the most exciting of them all. The 76ers improved to 5-4. In overtime, over the Rockets and Dwight Howard. Really good game. Houston went up quickly in the first quarter. They were up 31-28 after one, but Philadelphia battled back in what was really no defense at all. They put up 60 in the first half to the 57 of Houston, so Houston really lacking defense. But Houston, they were down by 3, but they put up 33 to the Philadelphia's 20 in the third quarter, and they were feeling good. They were now up by 10 points, so they felt good, and they felt like they could get the win. But Philadelphia, exactly what they needed in the fourth quarter. They put the defensive stops on for the first time, allowing the Houston only 16 points, and then they outscore Houston 17-11 in overtime. A very exciting game, and a big game from Philadelphia's James Anderson, who went for 36 points, 5 rebounds, and 3 steals. Did have 5 fouls, but luckily he was able to stay in the game because, he was a really big part of this team. But, of course, we also got to talk about a couple of other big players. Tony Roten, 18 points. Thaddeus Young, 15 points. But what's big about Tony Roten is, he's stepping in for the injured Michael Carter-Williams, and he put up a triple-double. 18 points, 11 assists, 10 rebounds. Great game from Tony Roten as he steps in for Michael Carter-Williams. And, you really can't step in that well for a Rookie of the Year candidate any better. A triple-double is just amazing, really making his impact felt. And don't take away any credit from the Rockets. Rockets players all had phenomenal games. Dwight Howard, 23, 15, and 6. Got Jeremy Lin, 34 and 12. Patrick Beverley played well. James Harden, of course, did not play. He was injured on a day-to-day. Chandler Parsons played well as well, but they just didn't have it in them. Omer Sheikh, you can tell that he's not getting many minutes. You know, he got 4 minutes off the bench and did nothing. Absolutely nothing. Rockets unable to win the game, and Philadelphia now improved to 5-4. So that's a big win for them as they look to bolster their backing. You know, they really want to be considered an elite team, even though most people have discounted them, and they are making their case heard. To another game in Orlando, the Bucks lose to the Magic 94-91 in a matchup of teams that have both struggled. Bucks dropped to 2-5, Magic now to 4-5, though the Magic are 4-1 at home. The Bucks, led by O.J. Mayo, who's really stepped into his own, 25 points, 7 rebounds, and 2 assists. Meanwhile, the Magic, led by Aaron Aflalo, who's been on fire the past couple of games, 36 points, 8 rebounds, 6 assists, and 2 steals. Nikola Vucevic also puts up a double-double with 17 points and 11 rebounds. The only other game to go final so far, Charlotte and Boston. And Boston drops to 4-5 as the Bobcats go to 500. They win 89-83, led by Al Jefferson, who had a 22-point, 11-rebound night. So good night for him. Charlotte Bobcats all around not their best game, but they were able to put the defensive stops in work. Boston really struggled. Jeff Green, 19 points, and he was their leading scorer, 16 from Jordan Crawford. No other players in double figures are their starters, but Courtney Lee and Gerald Wallace were able to get into double figures as well. Vitor Favorani, one of the big surprises so far this year, was able to put up 7 points and 9 rebounds. Now, on to the other games going on right now. 9 minutes and 3 seconds remaining in the fourth quarter. The Raptors are up on the Grizzlies 84-74. They're being led by Kyle Lowry and DeMar DeRozan, both players really coming into their own this year. Mike Conley leading the Grizzlies with 26 points. We'll keep you updated on that game and all the other live games as well. Timberwolves versus Cavs. The Cavs are 3-5, but they did pick up a win against the Timberwolves. Cavs yet to win away from home, and it doesn't look like it's going to get any better with 4:43 remaining in the fourth quarter. It is 119-87. Timberwolves up by 32 points despite Kyrie Irving's 20 points. And it's much in part to Kevin Love's 33 points. And Ricky Rubio doing his fair share. 16 points and 16 assists. He's having a phenomenal night, as well as Minnesota is killing the Cavaliers in the Twin Cities. Right now, the Knicks and the Hawks, one of the marquee games. Knicks are up. They are 1-1 on the road, but they're trying to pick up their first really big road win. And they are up by 5. And it's been much in part, of course, to Carmelo Anthony. Though Carmelo Anthony shooting, once again, a little more than most people. He's 9 of 23, but he does have 25 points. On the Atlanta Hawks side, Paul Millsap has hit a slump lately. He's only been able to put up 6 points. Jeff Teague and Al Horford both in the 20s. This game will probably go down to the wire. Now into the earlier games. It is in the third quarter. Only 39 seconds remaining. The Spurs up by 11 on the Wizards. They just started to pull away again. You know, the Wizards brought it close again, but the 7-1 Spurs are looking to go to 8-1, mainly because of Kawhi Leonard, Tiago Splitter, and Tony Parker's great performances. Tim Duncan, 1-for-12, only 2 points. Not his best game ever. But, you know, the Spurs are still winning. They're getting contributions from other players as well. On the other side, you know, you have Marta Webster has been playing terrifically off the bench. Bradley Beal with 15 points and John Wall with 14 points. This team is developing. They're not at the same level as the Spurs, but they are getting better. We'll keep you updated on that game. Denver versus the Lakers. They are 1 second away from halftime. Very close. 60-54 Nuggets. They've been led by Kenneth Faried, who's been in a lot of trade talks with the Knicks for Iman Shumpert. We'll see how that plays out. I'll talk about that later. And Ty Lawson has 10 points as well. For the Lakers, Jordan Hill, he's been in the starting role, and he really played very, very well yesterday in the starting role. And he's got 13 points again tonight, so he's making the most of it. Game just hit halftime. Pelicans-Jazz, 55-45 Pelicans in Utah. Anthony Davis, 8 points, 9 rebounds. Eric Gordon has 13 points to lead all scores. On the other side, Enes Kanter with 10, so a very low-scoring game for individuals. But, of course, the Pelicans are having pretty good offensive night so far. 55, you know, you double it, 110. Probably won't go like that, but that's how it is right now. So that is our scores right now. And we're going to look at our standings really quickly, division by division. You go right now in the Eastern Conference, and I just said Philadelphia, they are in first right now, 5-4. Boston in second at 4-5. In the Central, you know, 2-5 is Milwaukee and Detroit, 3-5 Cleveland, and 3-3 Chicago, but there is one team standing alone. The only undefeated team left in the NBA, the Indiana Pacers. They are 8-0, and they have been unstoppable. They deserve that top team right now. They deserve the top seed in the East how they're playing. Miami 5-3, followed by Atlanta 4-3, and Charlotte 4-4 in the Southeast, so it's a tight division there. In the Northwest, Oklahoma City 5-1, Portland 5-2, and Minnesota 5-3. So teams that are definitely getting wins, all playing very well. In the Pacific, Phoenix 5-2, a team that many people thought would be bad. They are the Sixers of the Western Conference. But Eric Bledsoe has proved that he is becoming an elite quarterback, an elite point guard. Point guards are basically the quarterbacks of basketball. That's understandable. An elite point guard in this league. The Clippers and the Warriors trail them at 5-3. The Lakers 4-5. And Sacramento, really the only team that hasn't been able to get many wins, 1-5. San Antonio in first in the Southwest, as always, 7-1. Dallas 5-3. Houston 5-4. New Orleans 3-4. 3-5, and Memphis 3-4. So it's actually relatively good in that division. Not many terrible teams. Of course, Utah still has the crown as the only team that has yet to win a game at 0-8. It doesn't look like they'll be winning one today either. So now that we've covered that, let's start by talking about who has a better shot to beat LeBron for MVP. Because, you know, the Heat have been playing well. But LeBron, you know, he's not at the same level as he has been. So, with Derrick Rose not really being able to do anything, what happens? You know, he hasn't played with Derrick Rose not playing well, and, you know, all of these other players that a lot of people thought would be elite not playing at MVP levels. Obviously, Harden hasn't played at the same level. Dwight Howard not playing that well. Who are the people that really could dethrone him? Because look at it here. LeBron has two MVPs in a row, and nobody's ever done it. And nobody's ever won three in a row. You know, Karl Malone beat out Michael Jordan in 97. Derrick Rose topped LeBron in 2011. So who does it? Well, I think that right now there are four players that really could do it. I think Chris Paul could do it. Kevin Love could do it. Paul George could do it. And Kevin Durant could do it. So I'm going to rank in order those four players and see, you know, who do I think could possibly take away the MVP title from him? Well, you know, you look at a guy like Kevin Love. Let's do him first. Kevin Love, I mean, you know, a couple of years ago, wasn't getting much respect. Not many people really thought he was that great. But as the years went on, you know, he started to get more and more respect. And you see this year averaging 26 points and 15 rebounds, and of course a 0.4 blocks, so not that efficient in the blocks and steals categories, but very efficient in the player efficiency rating. Scores a lot, you know, he's just been playing very well, and I think he definitely deserves to be in this MVP conversation. But the thing when I look at him is that there's a guy on his team named Ricky Rubio, which doesn't really help, because Ricky Rubio, you take Ricky Rubio away from this team, and you replace him with a subpar point guard. You know, you look at their team. Let's look at Minnesota last year. Without Rubio, when Rubio wasn't healthy, and yes, you can say, well, Kevin Love has developed now, but let's just take a look at last year, because he was really good last year. Let me go to their roster really quickly here. You know, oh, I can't get it. Whatever. But you replace him with a subpar point guard, and it's not the same. Rubio has terrific vision. He can see the court so well, find open Kevin Love who can hit the jumpers. Okay, Kevin Love's stats last year, 18.3 points per game. Oh, I can't use last year. He was injured. But let's go to 2011-2012. He only played 55 games in that one as well, but that's a much better sample size. 26 points per game, 13 rebounds. Now you go to this year, he's up in most categories. So he's picked it up in a lot of the categories. So it's obvious that Rubio makes a difference. And that doesn't really help because Rubio, you know, takes away from it. It's the same thing that, you know, some people would say of Kevin Durant. But, you know, you have a lot of good players, and now you add another one, Nikola Pekovic, who's been a phenomenal rebounder. It doesn't really help Kevin Love, but I do think he deserves to be in this MVP conversation. But for the moment, he is in fifth place for MVP, because I still think LeBron is number one. But out of these players that I'm talking about right now, he's in fourth. Now, we're going to head over to Indiana, and we are going to talk about a guy who, over the past year, has shown himself as an elite player in this league, and that's Paul George. In the series against the Heat, he was the driving force behind this team. And this year, he's come out and played very well as well. 25 points a game, 8 rebounds, 4 assists, and he's getting 2 steals a game, sometimes getting a block, but he's playing very well, and he's leading this 8-0 Pacers team, and that's really what puts him over Kevin Love. I think they are equal in skill. They are equal in stats, but the difference is one team is 5-3, and one team is 8-0. And Paul George has been the driving force behind this team. He's played phenomenally in the first 8 games, shooting 477. Mainly, the only reason he's shooting that badly is because of the games against Chicago and Toronto, 2 of the games. But besides that, 563, 571, 667, phenomenal numbers. He's shooting 379 from behind the arc, 900 from the line, playing very well, and he has made his case for the possible MVP this year. But once again, he is good, but you look at the team, and there's a lot of good players around that, and you can say that with LeBron as well, but when Paul George sits out, how much worse are the Pacers? Well, you take LeBron out of the Heat, and they're good. But they're not an NBA championship team. They wouldn't have beaten the Pacers. They might not even beat the Bulls. They're just not as good of a team without him. You look at Paul George, and you still have a really well-rounded team. You know, the Heat aren't well-rounded. The Pacers are really well-rounded. Danny Granger, who could step in, fits in there well. You got Roy Hibbert, who would be starting. George Hill. You got C.J. Watson coming off the bench. Lance Stevenson, Luis Scola. It's still a really good team. And for that reason, he's sitting behind Chris Paul and Kevin Durant. But that's also why Kevin Durant is my next player. So let's go to KD, the guy who a lot of people think may actually dethrone him. He's averaging 30 points a game. That's just 30. That's pretty average. Well, it has been a really long time since anybody got 30. But 7 rebounds and 4 assists a game. And you're saying, how can you say that he's not? Well, let's go to the game against the tough team, Minnesota. 13 points, shoots 4 of 11. He does absolutely nothing. How about that? Gets in foul trouble, lots of turnovers, and his turnovers numbers haven't been great by any means. Go against Dallas, only 23 points there. Unable to do much. Shooting 438. Let's go to another. Well, tonight will be an option, even though LA isn't a bad team, but they haven't played many teams. And the teams, you know, he's been torching haven't been elite teams, you know, not great defensively. So I want to see him when he goes up against a good team. You know, he played a good team in Minnesota and he couldn't do it. But then, of course, there's a guy on his team that just makes it that much harder. And his name is Russell Westbrook. Because this guy, sure, right now he isn't putting up lights out numbers, but he just came back from injury. As the season goes on, he's going to take more and more shots, and he's going to score more and more, and KD's numbers will go down. That's just the fact of the matter. And when it comes down to it, I'm not sure that KD can distribute to him and still bolster his numbers in the same way other people can. And when you look at Chris Paul, it's not about his points. It's about his distributing. And even with his distributing, he averages, 12 assists right now. four rebounds, and he's putting up 21 points a game. And he makes any team good. He made the Hornets look good. There we go. I didn't say the Pelicans. I almost said the Pelicans because he did play in New Orleans. But no, it's the Hornets because that's the team he played on. He makes every player on his team better. He averages 12 assists consistently. Against Miami, sure, he doesn't shoot well, but he will get the assists. He got 12 assists in that game. In the game he fouled out, still put up 18 points and 10 assists. So yes, he gets in foul trouble, and he gets in foul trouble actually a pretty good amount of the time. But every game he plays well. Golden State, one of the tougher games, puts up 42 and 15. Houston, another tough game, 23 and 17. Houston again, 14 and 13. So the tough games, he comes out and he plays. Yeah, they have all of these talented players. Blake Griffin and DeAndre Jordan are big. J.J. Redick, a big shooter. Jamal Crawford. But it's not like he just did it with his team. As I said, he did it with the Hornets. Oh, I hate how they change the logos on, you know, when you go to a stat on a player and look at his past years, it's no longer a Hornets logo. It's a Pelicans logo. I guess I gotta accept it. But even then, putting up 11, 10, 11, 11, those are terrific numbers. And he is showing why he should be number two on the MVP list. I do think Kevin Durant's a better player, but for right now, Chris Paul is my number two for the MVP award. So, now that we've done MVPs, let's talk about the New York Knicks. And apparently, they are going to make a strong move to sign a guy I was just talking about, Kevin Love. So, they have devised an off-season strategy in 2015 that includes making a strong push for K-Love. The Knicks are buried in salary cap hell through 2014, awaiting Amari Stoudemire's departure and Tyson Chandler and Bargnani. But in 2015, they will have lost all that cap. And once that happens, you know, they have what they need to lure him in. They've got a lot of talented players. They've already got Carmelo Anthony. They might be trading for Iman Shumpert. This team would look very good if they could add Kevin Love. I mean, not Iman Shumpert. They might be adding Kenneth Faried. You know, they adding Kevin Love would be a really good thing, but I just don't see this happening. I think Minnesota is already heading in the direction he wants. You can already see them developing. And I think that he's going to stay there. I think he's going to be one of those players that decides, you know, I'm going to stay with the team that drafted me. I'm going to stay with the team that made me who I am. The team that has added Pekovic, that has added Rubio. And they are going to continue to bolster the team. Shabazz Muhammad still developing. Got a lot of players on that team. And I think he'll stay there because I think he knows that they are doing what they need to do to win. It's not like they're just sitting there and letting what happens happen. They added Gorgui Dieng in the draft as well. Derek Williams coming off the bench. Kevin Martin. J.J. Barea. So this team looks good. It looks really good. And moving in the right direction, why change it? So in the end, I think the Knicks are unfortunately going to miss out. And I think K-Love is staying in Minnesota. Next up on our list, Dirk Nowitzki passes Jerry West in the all-time scoring list. And he's obviously now he's going after Reggie Miller. He now stands at 25,197 points, trying to make his way up there. And he's also making his case for the Hall of Fame. And right now, he's only, let's see here, 80 points behind Reggie Miller. So he is getting close, or 82 points behind Reggie Miller, to be exact. And I think he's getting very close, and I think he will pass him very soon. I'd say 5 games tops, and good for him. You know, he's getting closer and closer to those numbers, and that would put him 15th on the list and basically, you know, lock up his guarantee into the Hall of Fame. He is a phenomenal player, and I wish him the best of luck as he continues to climb up that list. Now we're going to talk about Steve Nash. You know, it was injured, a back injury, and he visited back specialists at 2 p.m. today. D'Antoni said his mood was normal, upbeat. That's from @JaniceCarr. That was 2 days ago, so we're going to see how he does today. From @Lakers, Steve Nash has been diagnosed with having nerve root irritation. He's expected to be out of action a minimum of 2 weeks. So, the Lakers have played well without him, but it's still never good to lose a guy who has great passing vision, just like Rubio. He is a driving catalyst on this team. And they really don't want to lose him, but that is how it is. And hopefully the Lakers, you know, can support themselves without Steve Nash. And we'll see how that turns out. We'll give you an update on all the scores when we come back. So stick around, and when we come back, besides the scores, we will also do my starting five, best all time, sparked by Michael Jordan's interview with NBA 2K14 on his top five all time. So we'll give you his and mine when we get back.
Your presentation of National Sports is brought to you by Spreaker.com. Broadcast and listen to new radio and music with one low monthly rate. Your show will be right back after this word from your local stations. You can contact National Sports in a number of ways through Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter with the label National Sports. We love to have you guys a part of our show and can easily join us also through text or call. You're listening to the National Sports Radio Station on Spreaker.com.
Remix! Oh. Woo! 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. This the I'm a Boss Remix! Woo! Oh.
I'm riding, dazzling, riding by Hollywood side, right inside of my Beamer 760. I try me, let off 60 shots again. We got the city hiding, popping like it's supposed to be.
Yo, what's up? It's Noah Taborda. We're back from our commercial break on Full Court Press, our fourth episode today, November 13th. Here we go as we dive into our last couple 10-15 minutes of the show. And we start off with the scores. We won't go over the finals. We'll just say the scores really quickly. Bobcats 89, Celtics 83, Bucks 94, Magic 94, Bucks 91, and the 76ers defeat the Rockets in Philly in overtime 123-117, and a score that's just gone final. Love scored 33 points, Rubio with a career-high 16, and the Timberwolves are now 6-3, Cavs 3-6, 124-95. Minnesota kills the Cavaliers. Now, the game's still going on. 1 minute left in the game, and the Raptors are running away with it. 101-286 on the Grizzlies. They have been led by Rudy Gay's 23 points, and they are going to try to keep moving up towards that 500 mark, because they'll go to 4-5, now 52 seconds remaining. 11 seconds remaining in the game, and the Knicks will be moving to 3-4, the Hawks to 4-4. They're up 95-87. Wizards down by 18, 3:26 remaining in the fourth quarter, to the Spurs, 89-71. Lakers Nuggets without Steve Nash, of course, and they are losing, of course, 63-57. Can't get it done. They got to find ways without Nash. They are now down 65-57 after Lawson hit a jumper to push his point total to 12. Pelicans up on the Jazz. Jazz still winless, and it looks like they'll stay that way. 61-45 in the third quarter. Just started in the first 10 minutes in, actually. Suns and Blazers both 5-2. It is 19-15 Blazers. Kings are 1-5. Nets are 2-4. One of the big disappointments on the year. And they are up 19-17. By the way, Nuggets just scored again to extend the lead to 8 points. No games have gone final. Wow. Okay, Kyle Korver just got a defensive rebound for the Hawks, and this should finish up the game. I expect to finish up the game. I'd be really surprised if it wasn't over by now. I don't know. It's just not, doesn't seem to want to end. They don't want to end the game. They don't want it. Okay, but let's get to it. And for the last segment, I'm going to reveal my starting five. And I'll start by telling you Michael Jordan and his starting five. He also did his favorite shoes and dunks. I will include that link on the Facebook page. So, Michael Jordan, of course, we all know he is one of the greatest, if not the best, in my opinion, the best player of all time. And, of course, his starting five, including him. And his first person he said was Scottie Pippen. Straight up. He said, of course, you know. Magic Johnson, he said, James Worthy and Hakeem Olajuwon. So, once again, point guard there, Magic. Shooting guard would, of course, be MJ. Small forward, Scottie. Power forward, James Worthy. And then, of course, at center, we have Hakeem Olajuwon. And I only agree with two of those. And let's start with the point guard. I go Magic Johnson. You know, you look at his numbers, just phenomenal. And, of course, Michael Jordan is, of course, going to be the starting shooting guard. He is the greatest player of all time. And he deserves to be there. But we hit the small forward talk. And that's where we are not in agreement. From then on, I just can't agree with him. Let's start out by talking about Scottie Pippen, and I'm going to put him up statistically against my pick, LeBron James. And now people are going to be like, oh, LeBron doesn't deserve to be there. He's not a Hall of Famer yet. Well, let's look at his career numbers. 27.5 points per game, and 7-7. So that's about 28, 7-7. Good numbers there. One block, basically, per game. Two steals. Only around three turnovers. So now let's go to Scottie Pippen and go to his career stats. Well, his career stats, 16 points, 3 rebounds, 5 assists. So let's go to points immediately. 16-28. LeBron wins that. Steals, 2-2. Tied. Blocks, 1-1. Tied. Assists, 5-7, LeBron takes that. Rebounds, 7-6.4, LeBron takes it. Field goal percentage, 473-491, LeBron takes it. Free throw, 747-704, LeBron takes it. And you're going to say, well, it's not all statistics, it's championships as well, but LeBron is already climbing up that ladder. And I think it's a disgrace to have LeBron in the best player of all time talk when Scottie Pippen isn't, and then put Scottie Pippen above him. We all know that Michael Jordan doesn't like LeBron James for whatever reason. I honestly don't understand it. LeBron was Michael Jordan's, one of Michael Jordan's biggest fans of all time, and really Michael Jordan just pushed him away, really didn't want to share the spotlight. It's kind of selfish to me, but LeBron James is my small forward. Now, power forward is definitely one of the trickier positions to do, and I went with another one of those guys that played in the era of Michael Jordan. I went with Karl Malone. What a phenomenal player. You know, drafted 13th overall in 1985 out of Louisiana Tech. Played 19 years in the NBA, 18 of them with the Jazz. Only his last year where he didn't even play a full year with the Lakers. And up until that last year, he put up 20 points per game. Only two seasons. Didn't put up 20. That was his first year and his last year. Finishing with career numbers of 25, 10, 4, and then basically 1-1. So, very good. Very good. That's a little bit of an understatement. Very great numbers. You know, just very difficult to put up numbers like that. Now we look at James Worthy. He was first overall by the Lakers in 82. Which was only, I believe, 3 years before Karl Malone. And, you know, we're going to go to Karl Malone, one of Karl Malone's better years, 89 to 90, 4 years in. That would still be in the prime of Worthy's career. And you see this, 31 points, 11 and 3. James Worthy, that same year, finish with I'm talking about 89 or 89-90. 89-90. That same year, Worthy 21-6-3. Look at his career numbers. 17-5-3. And statistically, Karl Malone is once again significantly better. You can't get on that. He was part of the dream team, one of the greatest teams of all time. James Worthy only played 12 years, didn't play as much as Karl Malone, which doesn't help his case either. And you look his rookie year, he only started one game. Karl Malone's rookie year, he started 76. And his career, he started basically every game he played. 76 out of 81, 82 out of 82, 82 out of 82, 88 out of 82, 82 or 80 out of 82. That don't sound like 88 out of 82. 82, 82, 81, 81, 82, 82, 81, 82, all the way down, 49, 49, 82, 82, 81, 81, 80. The only season that he didn't play every game he could, or start every game he could, was that rookie season. James Worthy, you see, 1 out of 77, 53 out of 82, 76 out of 80, 73 out of 75, 82 out of 82, 72 out of 75, 81, 81, 80, 80, 74 out of 78, 69 out of 82, 2 out of 80. It's just not the same. He didn't play as much, and he is a Hall of Famer. He is one of the greatest of all time. 7-time All-Star player. But Karl Malone was a 2-time MVP. Something that James Worthy never got, though he did get a Finals MVP, which does help him over Karl Malone. But Karl Malone was a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11-time NBA First Teamer. Something that James Worthy never did. James Worthy was All-NBA third team twice. Karl Malone was All-NBA team second twice and third team once. All-rookie, he was on his All-rookie first team. James Worthy was on that team as well. He was on All-defensive first team 3 times in a row. James Worthy never did that. All-NBA second team, James Worthy never did that. All-Star Game MVP, James Worthy never did that. So Karl Malone has definitely got to go over James Worthy. And of course, his last one. This is the hardest one I had a time, you know, arguing with. Because Hakeem Olajuwon, whew, that guy was a monster. You know, finished his career 22 points per game, 11 rebounds, 3 assists, 3 blocks, 2 steals. So he was a terrific player. But I went with classic guy, a guy that is almost impossible to argue with because he was incredible in everything he did, and that is Wilt Chamberlain. Sure, he didn't play his whole career in the NBA. Some of it was in the ABA as well. But you look at his NBA stats, and it's hard to go against what he did. Let me pull up the points per game. Well, his first season, Philadelphia Warriors, 37.6, he put up insane numbers. For his career, 30 points a game. He had a career average 50 points a game. And he did what he wanted when he wanted to. You could not stop him. Ever. It just was, he couldn't do it. Rebound-wise, you look at what he did. He was a monster there. Total rebounds per game. He put up years where he would go 25 rebounds a game. That's 22 rebounds in his career. 4 assists. I don't care what era it was in. He was unstoppable. Not nearly unstoppable. Not, you know, sometimes he would get stopped. He was unstoppable. You could not do anything to get him out of the way. And though Hakeem Olajuwon, the Dream, was phenomenal, Wilt Chamberlain takes it over him just because of his sheer dominance, his sheer power. You know, when he did it, when he wanted it, he would do it. Not many players can say that. You know, he wanted 100, he got 100. And that was in a tie without three-pointers as well, which makes it that much more impressive. Wilt Chamberlain, crazy good. He makes my top five. So in the end, my top five, Magic Johnson, Michael Jordan, LeBron James, Karl Malone, and Wilt Chamberlain disagree on 3 out of the 5. Of course, point guard and shooting guard agreement, Magic Johnson and Michael Jordan. But the ones I changed, LeBron at small forward, Karl Malone at power forward, and we have Wilt Chamberlain, Wilt the Stilt, at the center position. And that is my top five. So now that we have hit the 40 mark, it's time to wrap it up. And we are going to start, or we're going to end, really, by doing the scores. Well, final games, a lot more have gone final. Spurs defeat the Wizards 92-79 behind Tony Parker's 16, though Martell Webster puts up 21 for the Wizards. Knicks defeat the Hawks 95-91. Timberwolves over the Cavs 124-95. Raptors over the Grizzlies 103-87. Bobcats over the Celtics 89-83. Magic over the Bucks 94-91. Rockets lose to the 76ers 123-117 in overtime. Now games going on in the third quarter. The Nuggets up by 9 on the Lakers. Or now up by 7 as the Lakers just scored a Nick Young layup. 75-68, 4:11 remaining in the third quarter. Also in the third quarter, the Pelicans up by 9 on the Jazz as they look to send the Jazz 2-0-9. They are up 70 as Anthony Davis hit his second free throw. He now is at 17 points and 13 rebounds, so a double-double for him. They're up 70-60. Just at the end of the first quarter, Trailblazers lead 25-22 against the 5-2 Suns. So that's a good matchup of two 5-2 teams. Now the biggest disappointment of the year, the Nets down by 11 points to the 1-5 Kings as DeMarcus Cousins going off. This Nets team, big disappointment. And just tipped off, Clippers, Thunder, it is 0-0. It's going to be a great game. It's been a great NBA season so far. And so, with that, for all of national sports, for the whole NBA, and for everybody in Chicago, I'm Noah Taborda. Have a great night. Enjoy basketball for the next week. I will be on Thursday, or not, today is Wednesday, tomorrow's Thursday. I'll be on a Friday with College Basketball Mania, debuting my new show, and then sometimes next year, week, I will be doing college. I will be doing football monthly, which I changed from weekly to monthly. And of course, Sunday, definitely catch the marquee show of the weekend, Blake and Noah, LA to Chicago. So have a good night and enjoy the rest of the week. See you later.